space, the final frontier. Gene Roddenberry invites you to go where few have gone before. Behind the scenes at the making of Star Trek, the motion picture. More than 6 years went into the planning of the film before cameras began rolling on August 8, 1978. In all, 11 of Paramount's 32 sound stages were used to shoot the movie. Construction crews worked around the clock on 21 separate sets in order to stay a step ahead of the tight shooting schedule. The large cast included not only human characters, but 15 different alien life forms. The USS Enterprise, a star in her own right, received all the attention lavished on the greatest superstar. Magicam's Hollywood studios built two models of the Enterprise. The larger 8 feet long was used for the dry dock sequences and other close-ups. For long shots, Magicam built a 20-inch model with less detail. The models were created especially for the motion picture to reflect the 23rd century specifications of the newly refurbished Enterprise. It took 6 months to complete construction of the models made from vacuum-form plastic. Detail work continued on them throughout the filming as special effects director Doug Trumbull made additional alterations. Even while the Enterprise in dry dock was still being built, the model was impressive in its setting. The Enterprise received almost as much attention as a NASA spacecraft, although it seems unlikely that NASA maintenance crews use pink feather dusters. The Enterprise was set on the second of two dry docks built for her. The first, constructed when Star Trek was planned as a television movie, could not be used because of the perfection of tiny detail work needed for a theater-sized screen. No, it's not space-age dentistry. Each tiny mirror reflects a pinpoint of light on the hull, sculpturing the contours and highlighting the design of the starship. As the Enterprise prepares to leave dry dock for her encounter with a force which threatens to destroy the planet Earth, she is a majestic craft. Among the other models crafted by Magicam was the intricate space station, Epsilon 9, destroyed at the film's beginning by the unknown threat. The Klingon battle cruisers met the same fate. But each of the dozen identical models were built with the same care as the Enterprise. With special attention paid to their blow-up ability. During filming, the Enterprise crew reacts with horror as the probe begins its examination of the bridge. From all appearances, rehearsals were equally frightening. The intensity of light was nearly blinding, and dark glasses were used by everyone for protection. On the Star Trek set, there was certainly a lot more to being an actor than signing autographs. The actors took trips. They spent a lot of time hanging around. They were frequently up in the air. And they occasionally got punchy. In a scene shot from the waist up, shoes didn't really matter. But could this be 23rd century Starfleet footgear? And speaking of feet, no, it's not Bigfoot. Just a Bigfoot, part of a Vulcan statue. Bringing Vulcan to the screen involved a special film technique, the matte process, which joins live action with a painted background by means of a special optical printer. The landscape of Yellowstone National Park was the model for Vulcan, and some of the early scenes were actually shot at the park. But the majority of the Vulcan sequence was filmed at Paramount. Although the rest of the sets were created indoors on sound stages, Vulcan was filmed outside. The only way to match the outdoor quality of light achieved during the Yellowstone filming. In the matte process, a background is painted with blank space left for the live action sequence. Then when the live action is filmed, the background and the actual live footage are fused together to achieve a realistic completed sequence. Many artist renderings and models preceded the construction of V'ger, the most complex and extraordinary of the sets. During rehearsals and filming, live actors replaced the paper figures almost exactly. Created in 4.5 weeks on stage 15, the set was built in a 360-degree circle with 9 sections, some of which could be removed to achieve additional camera angles. Actors and technicians quickly learned to walk carefully on the Bijou set to avoid stepping through the plexiglass panes, which were part of the construction. Rehearsals for part of the sequence took place on wooden boxes to simulate the stepping stones which led the Enterprise crew to V'ger's heart. Nearly every light in Hollywood was used to create the spectacular effects of the film's climax, with specially devised instruments underneath the set throwing ribbons of light through the plexiglass panes. In the motion picture, the Enterprise crew included a new alien member, the navigator, Ilea, from the planet Delta 4. Deltans are hairless, except for eyebrows and eyelashes. And for her American film debut, actress Persis Kambada underwent an unusual transformation. Makeup supervisor Fred Phillips, associated with Star Trek since the first television pilot, was the natural choice to perform the delicate operation. Freddie arrived at the final decision for the Vulcan ears, which became Spock's trademark. So you might say that one of his specialties is creating unique and unforgettable aliens. What does it feel like to become instantly bald? Persis's face tells the whole story. To keep her new look in perfect shape, a special present from Gene Roddenberry. There's no question about it. For Persis Kambada, bald is definitely beautiful. Other alien characters appeared briefly at Starfleet headquarters in San Francisco and as part of the Enterprise crew. Created by Gene Roddenberry, Fred Phillips, and costume designer Bob Fletcher, they included Arcturians, who provide infantry for the Federation. Zaranites, who breathe fluorine gas and must wear breathing apparatus in Earth environments. Andorians, who also appeared in the Star Trek television series. And Canormians, whose additional brain structure enables them to communicate over long distances. As shooting progressed, the cast and crew became very much like a huge family. Special occasions like Robert Wise's birthday were celebrated by everyone on the set. But the largest crowd gathered to film the wreck deck sequence, in which the full Enterprise crew assembled to watch the unknown force the Enterprise would face. Over 300 extras were hired for the single day shooting. 125 of the people on the set were Star Trek fans, invited by Gene Roddenberry and his assistant Susan Sackett to be a part of the long-awaited film. The massive set, which took hundreds of hours to complete, was used only for that one day, then dismantled. But Star Trek is more than movie sets. more than the television show, as the Star Trek experience continues.